So thank you, and thanks to the organizer. Very pleased to be here. So the theorem that I will mention in the second part of the talk is a theorem with Bob Jerrard regarding the leapfrogging phenomenon for the Gross-Pitaevskii equation. I've been working with Philippe Graveja and Evelyn Millot trying to extend this analysis or to adapt this analysis to the Euler equation, and we have failed so far. But then I will start explaining some, so start with some basic things on the Euler equation and try to give the intuition. So first, what leapfrogging is, what are the difficulties that are still there, and then I will show the result for Gross-Pitaevskii and explain the proof. And you will see also where the gaps are for the Euler equation, and maybe that will give some ideas to some of you, or some of you would have some ideas to make some progress. There is a pointer, yes. So the I will start with the 2D Euler equation in the 2D Euler equation, which I wrote immediately in a vorticity formulation. So omega is a function here, and say on R2, and V is a velocity field of the fluid, which is recovered from the vorticity through the Biot-Savart law, so the gradient perp of the green function of the Laplacian. And as you know, this equation, when in R2, is a transport equation. So the initial vorticity field is just transported by the flow, which is given by the velocity field. So you think of particles, you evolve them with the velocity field, and then you just transport the vorticity by this by the solution of this flow. This is going to have some infinite number. First, because it is a transport equation, all functions of the vorticity are conserved, in particular the total mass. But there are other interesting conserved quantities, in particular the center of mass, which I have rescaled here, the angular momentum, which is sometimes written in terms of the center of mass, centered at the center of mass already, and the energy. There are there are many much more conserved quantities, and one of the consequences of these conserved quantities, among the many consequences of these conserved quantities, is the fact that when you have a positive vorticity at initial time, then it remains somehow concentrated for all time. So if it has compact support, say at times equal zero, then most of its mass will stay in a bounded region for all time, because that depends only on conserved quantities, and a very easy way to see it. But it, of course, it requires that omega, that the vorticity is a constant sign, otherwise you see that it doesn't work. So I split the mass as a part which is in a ball around the center of mass of omega and the complement. Now the part which is on the complement, you just, since it is x is a distance at least r from the center, then you can minimize one by this, and there you see the one of the conserved quantities appear, the angular momentum. And so therefore you have this lower bound on the mass of vorticity contained in the ball of radius r centered at this center of mass, which does not move for which is a conserved quantity for the Euler equation in terms of the total mass. So if capital R is sufficiently big, you can make that as small as you wish. So it is a weak form of concentration of the vorticity. But of course, this only works for this will have an implication for later. This only works if omega is a sign, because otherwise you cannot do that. Okay, and there are solutions, of course, which are known not to stay compact in space. Well-known solutions are, if you take a patch with a plus and a patch with a minus, those two will behave like a traveling pair, and so they will not stay localized, say here, close to zero in space. But you could say, well, but they are still localized one close to each other, but you could cook up a different thing like that, and you would have two pairs that escape one from each other. So you take different signs, and so there is no way that it would be localized then. So this is something which is for which the sign of the vorticity is crucial. And now the kind of solution I will look at is precisely such kinds of initial data where I will put a scale epsilon, and so I will consider patch, which are, this is just to put a parameter in the problem. I could also use the distance between patch and make it big, but it is somehow easier this way. So they will behave with a diameter of size epsilon, and so that they have positive mass, the omega will be like epsilon minus 2 to the minus 2 into D in those patch. So if you do that, of course, and you rewrite this estimate for one patch, then you have that up to a factor epsilon square, all the mass is still contained in a ball of radius one. But this, of course, only works if you take one patch, because the smallness of L, the smallness of L, of course, x square is small only if omega is concentrated close to a point. But if you take two of them, then if x square is small here, it's not gonna be small there. And so this very simple heuristic does not work if you take multiple patches. Okay. So you cannot just use the invariant in that case to tell that. And the goal would be to say that such structure remain in time, possibly with a motion that you will later study. But it's not sufficient to use the invariants to do this. But what Marc Yoro and Paul Virenti did in in the 80s is to say, what we are going to say, so the Biot-Savart law is a linear law that transports the omega to the V. And since the Euler equation is a transport equation, if initially your vorticity can be divided in two, say I have one patch and a second patch, I transport each of these patch, then I have a way to split the vorticity at later time. So and this is just because it is a transport equation. And so the Biot-Savart law is singular only at the origin. Okay, and so when this patch is going to move by the Euler equation, I can consider the speed which is generated by himself, by Biot-Savart, and look at it as the singular object. But then there is also the speed which is implied by the other patch. And since initially they are at a finite distance, a O of one distance, then as long as they remain like that, I can treat this other term as a smooth or as a Lipschitz term. Okay. So what they did was just, now, even if you have multiple patch, just consider one of those patch, it will and move it with a flow where there is a velocity which is given by the Biot-Savart law of itself, and then the Biot-Savart law implied by the other patches, you just see it as a forcing term, as a Lipschitz forcing term. And it is Lipschitz as long as the two patches do not come close one to the other. You reformulate this as an abstract flow, and then you compute the time derivative of the invariance, or what was invariance for the pure Euler equation, and you just get that the time derivative of the center of mass now is just moved by the force F, and the important thing is the angular momentum here satisfies this equation. And if you notice that this quantity is zero just because this does not depend on x. So if you integrate this on x, by definition of pt, you get zero. Oh, forget about this. I put it out of the integral. So this is zero. Now you compare this with this, and you make the difference. You have f at x and f at the center of mass. So since f is Lipschitz, the distance, you can bound it by x minus pt. And then you get the x minus pt at the square times omega, which is Lt. So the angular momentum under such kind of flows is a good candidate for a Grandval inequality. So if it was epsilon square initially, it remains of size of order epsilon square for times of order one. But of course, there was an a priori assumption, is the fact that there is no interaction between the two, and so you need kind to bootstrap. and to be able to say that if they are initially at finite distance, then at least for an order one time, that will remain the case. And this is a difficult, that is a something which is not easy to prove, and it is actually the difficult part in all the work of Marquereau and Pulvirenti, and in rough terms, this is exactly what they proved. So if you start with patches that have size epsilon, whatever their form, their precise shape, they do not need to be disks, and at a distance which is order one, then for times of order one, they still remain separated, and they are no longer of size epsilon after a positive time. So they cannot prove that, but this is kind of an open problem called the filamentation problem. If you start with something of radius one, how far can the vorticity go? And when you once they are able to prove that the vortex patches remain at order one distance one from the other, then deriving their motion is just looking at the PDE and exchanging the omega by a delta, and the fact that they are concentrated just say that you approximate. This is just a consistency if you want. And so once you know that the patches are concentrated, you derive the motion law. The so-called point vortex systems for the patches, but so this is the difficult part of the proof, and this is the consequence. Okay, this is what I noted there. This system is an Hamiltonian, which I wrote there, the Kirchhoff Hamiltonian here, and actually, of course, it has to do with the energy of the Euler energy of such configurations, and which I wrote there. And the reason why I wrote it here was that the Hamiltonian of the point vortex systems here only depends on the relative positions of the patch one with each other. So xi is the center of mass of the patch I, and xj is the center of mass of the patch j, and they are small. So at the limit, you consider them as only as points. And the energy as a main term, If xi, xj has distance 1, this is the term which is order 1, as a main term, which is logarithmic diverging in epsilon, but which does not depend on the position of the points. Okay, and so that's the main, the main ingredient in the fact that you can use this this analogy here. Somehow you can treat the different patches separately. Okay, that can be reflected in a way in the fact that the main term of the energy is somehow independent of the position of the point. That will be something will be different in the axisymmetric 3D in Gross-Pitaevskii. So this is something I wanted to. This is just the integral of 1 over x cut off at epsilon. That one has been thoroughly studied, depending on the signs. Well, if the signs of the lambda I, lambda j are all the same, then you don't have collision problem. It's normal. If you have different signs, then you know you have those solutions that collide and so on. So this is a problem that they've been.
The long time behavior of this flow is not necessarily invented by Euler, right?
This is finite time, so yeah, there is a double scale there that should. Okay. Yes. One remark also is that this theorem by Marquereau and Pulvirenti works for arbitrary shape of patches. In particular, it does not use at all some optimizing property of the patch. Okay, it could be an ellipse. It could be an arbitrary patch, and so somehow it's not, if you want to make a parallel with multi-solitons and so on, it has nothing to do with that in the sense that it does not use the fact that, for example, one would be an optimum of the energy at a constant momentum and so on. It just uses the fact that if they are sufficiently far apart, then they do not interact. It's just a long-range non-interaction. And one could say, can we say more if the patches somehow have some solitonic behavior, in particular if they are some optimum of some conserved quantities under some constraints? And those objects are known, and the optimum are known. So for example, if you consider the circular patch, then its stability has been studied. And in particular, Wan and Paul Virenti have proved that if you consider a patch which is initially sufficiently close to the circular patch in L1, then it stays close in L1 for all time. Also because this just follows from inequalities on conserved, on this conserved quantity here, just the energy. And here also the remark that I would like to make, having in mind parallel with interaction of soliton and so on, this looks like a very good. So omega naught is the circular patch, and omega is here is the candidate patch. This looks like a non-degeneracy condition. The fact that there is a spectral gap, it actually isn't, and the reason is the lack of differentiability of the structure. The manifold on which you look at the manifold of vortex patches is not something which has a nice vector structure, and perhaps the easiest way to see it is consider the vortex patch. So this is a candidate. Now another candidate would be to dig a hole here and to put it here. Of course, so this you can do in one way. You can do it with a plus, but you cannot do it with a minus. So if this is a permitted direction of variation, the opposite of this variation is not permitted. Okay, so somehow there is not there is no tangent space, and you cannot see this inequality as a non-degeneracy inequality of a second derivative of something. Okay, so this is the main difference. And one other way to see that this would be absurd to think in this way is to replace the L1 norm by the L2 norm. You would just get a square here and a power 4 here, and then you would say, oh, this is not at all a non-degeneracy, it is a degeneracy. Okay. So this is one of the reasons why Euler, with respect to Gross-Pitaevskii, that I will present later, is badly behaved, is the fact that the coadjoint orbit of a vortex patch, so the set of candidates for Euler flow starting from a patch, does not have, at least for the L1 norm, which is the one that has been studied, does not have a good manifold structure. So this was a stability theorem in L1 for initial vortex patch that were close to the circular vortex patch, and Sideris and Vega in a short and elegant paper proved that it is actually a global nonlinear stability estimates. But they have a proof which relies on different conserved quantities than E. So this was based on the energy, and they used the conservation of momentum and angular momentum. And again, here I have put this factor 2, which somehow is the main one of the main trouble. And also the L1 norm is something you would like to avoid, I will explain later. So now I go to, so leapfrogging is something about vortex rings. So it's not in 2D, it's in 3D, but we'll look at the analysis in 3D axisymmetric flows without swirl here. So I wrote the Euler equation in 3D. Again, you recover the velocity from the vorticity through the Biot-Savart law, and I will only consider vorticities that are independent of. So I look in cylindrical coordinates, so z, r, and theta, and I will always use this. So this is r, z, and the slide this will be called h. So this is the half plane which you obtain in cylindrical coordinate, and I forgot about the theta. So if omega is independent of theta and aligned with e theta, in that case the velocity is a vector field in this half plane H, and the Euler equation translates into an equation for omega theta, which again is a transport equation, but a transport equation not for omega theta but omega over r. So if you divide, I should have written it differently. If you divide this equation by r, you would have d dt of omega theta over r is a v gradient of this quantity, and therefore this is transported. The fact is that it is transported by a velocity field which is not divergence free. Okay, divergence free if I look at it as a velocity field in H. Okay, so this makes things a little bit different, but still you have the fact that this quantity is transported. So if you go to higher values of R, the omega is increasing. Okay. Now I wrote the now the question is, assume I take a patch, a little patch like this, of vorticity, and what's going to happen to it? So here was a patch. So here it corresponds to to an annulus. Okay, if I draw a little patch, and I wrote, so this is just heuristic. I wrote the Euler equation in weak form for an arbitrary omega which is axisymmetric. And you can play a little bit with the right hand side using the so this is the expression of the fact that the omega is the curl of V. It remains of this form as and this is the fact that the divergence of V as a three-dimensional vector is zero, which translates in this way in the half space H. And then you get an equation, a weak formulation for the Euler equation, where on the right hand side you only get the V. Okay. You don't have the omega anymore. And so what can we guess about the this is the way I prefer to understand the motion of a vortex ring. This is the formulation I think it is the clearer to understand. Because we know it is a transport for omega over R. So this is a patch. It's going to stay a patch, at least locally concentrated. And we want to guess its motion. So to guess its motion, it suffices to take a function phi, which is an affine function. Okay. So if I take phi to be affine, then here those two terms that have second derivatives of phi will not be present. And I cut them off sufficiently far away where there is no where v has decreased already. Say, and so I have to understand these two forcing terms in order to guess what will be the motion of a small vortex patch here, so of a thin vortex rings. And the fact is that the Biot-Savart law in 3D looks locally like the Biot-Savart law in 2D. Well, for axisymmetric flows, it looks like the Biot-Savart law in 2D. And so if I have a small patch, the velocity at least close to it will look like that, like 1 over r times times e theta. Well, r, no, say 1 over rho, where rho is the distance to the center of patch and not this r. Okay. And so if you look at it, you see that this would be like 1 over r square times a cosine square of theta. And so this will integrate to something non-zero, and it will integrate precisely to log of the cutoff distance here of the patch. Okay. 1 over r square integrated, whereas this one here is 1 over r times cos theta, 1 over r sine theta, and that one integrates to 0 at main order. Okay, so the main, so this will give me the time derivative of the position. If omega is essentially a Dirac and this is an affine function, this is the main term. It will go in the z direction with a speed which is proportional to 1 over the distance to the center, so the radius of the annulus here, and multiply by the logarithmic of the width of the vortex. So this is, if you take into account the mass of the patch, which is at power 1 here and at power 2 here, you get that the main order in the speed is this lambda over r naught, so the intensity divided by the radius of the annulus multiplied by the log of the thickness of the patch, which we assume to be as epsilon, at least at initial time. Okay, and this is something that Helmholtz already knew, but he didn't do the computation with the equation in vorticity formulation. He just computed the very precise asymptotics for the velocity v close to the tube. And he argued that the main part, this 1 over r, had to cancel in some sense because it only make the vortex rotate on itself. But he already had precise computations and even to the next order, which were accurate. Actually, the existence of exact vortex rings can be so exact in the sense that exact traveling wave solutions, so solutions that do not deform in time except for the vertical translation, can be constructed by maximizing the Euler energy, which I wrote here in the vorticity formulation, under constraint that the momentum is fixed, sufficiently big. If it's too small, there is nothing. And the fact that the omega over r is a transport of what it was initially. This is also something which you have to impose, otherwise the maximization problem becomes trivially infinity. And okay, so this was long known. It was an idea of Arnold to use such such optimizing constraint minimization to get exact traveling waves, and it, there's a lot of work which in the end makes a very precise the fact that this problem is a solution provided p is larger than actually the momentum of the Hill vortex, and it has a shape of a vortex ring and so on. On different, so this is for an exact traveling wave solution. On a different direction, Benedetto Cagliotti and Marc Euro proved that almost maximizers of this problem behave like a vortex ring in a weak sense, in the sense that there is a point close to where you expect and a patch which has most of its mass there. So therefore it is a weak form of the Euler equation, and this form is going, and this patch is going with the right speed asymptotically. Okay. So that has been done for one vortex ring, and the extension to the case of two or more vortex rings, which would be the exact equivalent of the point vortex system that Marc Euro and Paul Viretti derived, has not been done for Euler. So this is still an open question. So this is something which I wanted to show, just a video of a vortex ring to show that this is an extremely, this seems to be an extremely stable solution of Euler equation. It was Kelvin who proposed to build it just with a cardboard which I tried myself. And as you can see, it looks very stable. It can go up to 10 or 20 meters in the lab without changing form. There is nothing very precise in the disk inside. It was actually my daughters who built the hole with a pair of scissors. And it goes really far without changing shape. And in the second half, so this was the study of vorticity for 3D Euler flows was in this 1858 paper of Helmholtz. In the second part, he has a paragraph which is not preceded by computations. It comes rather oddly, but he foresees what will be the behavior of the interaction between vortex rings. And so he claims that if you take two of them, so this one is going in this direction, and that one will come close, what's going to happen is that the exterior one is going to grow its radius, the following one will shrink. Since it will shrink, it will have a smaller radius, and so it will be quicker, because the speed is 1 over the radius. And so we'll catch that one, pass in front, and then they will exchange their role. That one will be behind, and so they will play this leapfrogging. One will pass inside the other. Actually, I have a video that was made by Lim in Singapore. It seems okay. So this is a lateral view of what's happening, and you can see at least one what leapfrogging motion. I thought this was a very, very delicate thing to reproduce in the lab, but I have some students from Grande École close to Jussieu that came to me because they had to do a TIPE. and we tried together to reproduce this and to measure some. And so in the end, they were at ESPCI where they were given many facilities. And you can almost see one of the leapfrogging motions with an apparatus which was built with the hand and with very few money. It is less less beautiful than the previous one. So this is the phenomenon that we would like to explain or to derive rigorously. And as I said, we have failed for the Euler equation, and I will show you how it goes for the Gross-Pitaevskii equation and try to mention the link between the two. So the Gross-Pitaevskii equation is a nonlinear defocusing Schrödinger equation. It has a parameter, epsilon, which is fixed in the equation. That's one of the main differences with Euler. Well, in the previous one, in 2D Euler, you can fix it in the initial data, and because it is transported, it will remain inside. But it is also a length scale, epsilon. So you will see that vortex tubes for Gross-Pitaevskii will have somehow a fixed epsilon scale here, whereas for Euler, it was the difficult thing, proving that concentrated vorticity remains concentrated. Somehow that will be the easy part in the Gross-Pitaevskii equation, but there will be some parts that are more tricky to deal with too. So U is with values in the complex, and so it is the Hamiltonian flow for this Ginzburg-Landau energy. And the analogy which I propose is the following. When you have a U here, you compute its Jacobian in the following way. So maybe the easiest way to understand this formula is to think of U as being since it's complex value, think it as a modulus exponential of a phase. Then from U you compute, we call its current, J of U, which is U cross gradient U, is just the gradient, basically the gradient of the phase, so rho squared the gradient of the phase. There is you see here in the Gross-Pitaevskii equation, energy, there is a penalization. When epsilon is small, this is a penalization of the fact that the modulus of U is not close to one. So you should think that for functions that have fields that have a bounded energy or controlled energy, rho should be close to one in most of the domain. So the current is essentially the gradient of the phase. And and the vorticity defined for Gross-Pitaevskii is the curl of this current. And so you see in particular that if you have a pure phase, that is if rho is exactly equal to zero, then the Jacobian is the curl of a gradient is identically equal to zero. So the main difference here with respect to Euler is that in Euler, when you have the vorticity, you recover the velocity. The velocity is completely defined by the vorticity through Biot-Savart. This is not the case in Gross-Pitaevskii. So in Gross-Pitaevskii, you see, if you are a pure phase, the vorticity is identically zero, but the velocity can be an arbitrary gradient of a phase. So there is some additional degree of your freedom. You can think of it also, I will mention that later, on the fact that somehow Gross-Pitaevskii as a non-compressible component, whereas Euler was incompressible, as a compressible component, whereas Euler was incompressible. And this is something I mentioned that. So I have written here the weak formulation of the Gross-Pitaevskii, say not the weak formulation because it does not characterize this, but I have written a weak form, a weak identity for the evolution of the Jacobian J of U when U is an axisymmetric solution of the Gross-Pitaevskii equation. This is the equation where this is the capital F. The exact form does not have such interest here. But the point is that I have written it here in a form that resembles very much what I wrote before for the Euler equation. And actually, so much that I can write these two equations here. This is for Gross-Pitaevskii, and this is for Euler, with the exact same capital F, just that it acts on different objects. For the Gross-Pitaevskii equation, it acts on the full gradient of U, which contains both the what I call the little j of U, the current, but also the non-compressible part. Whereas in Euler equation, it just acts on V. Okay. And so in a sense, to close the equation for Gross-Pitaevskii, you need also an equation for the compressible part. And this is the one I wrote here, which is because J of U is not a divergence, is not divergence free for R J of U in cylindrical coordinates. But it is almost divergence free, which you can see here it's I have put the epsilon on purpose. This quantity is part of the energy. Well, if you take its square, this is the potential part of the energy. So this equation tells you that on average in time, if you average in time, the divergence of J is epsilon. Okay. So this is the link with the incompressible Euler, but you need this additional equation. This is the loss, whereas the gain was the fact that the length scale was fixed. Also, another analogy, which you can see at the level of the existence of vortex rings. Here I just recopied what I had for the Euler equation. You can get exact vortex rings for Euler by maximizing the energy under momentum constraint. For the Gross-Pitaevskii, you can get exact traveling vortex rings by minimizing the energy under the exact equivalent constraint. So this is an analogy, but also a very big difference, because one is a maximization problem and the other one is a minimization problem. So the analogy tells you somehow that there is a saddle. For Euler, you are a maximizer in the set of fields that are incompressible, and if you allow compressibility, then you are a minimizer. Okay, so it's an analogy, but there is somehow a sharp difference here. One is a maximization and the other one is a minimization. Okay. So, okay, now how will we study interaction of vortex ring in which regime? So, as I said, Marcurel Pulvirenti did their analysis for arbitrary vortex patch. We will use the energy, and so we will use greatly the fact that some objects are optimizers of energy under fixed momentum. We will use that in a crucial way, so we cannot work with this very broad setting, and so I have to explain precisely what our initial data which will look like and their energy. So to do that, I consider an arbitrary curve, oriented curve in R3, which I see as a line of current capital J, and I consider the vector distribution, which has a 2 pi. This is something also which is important for Gross-Pitaevskii, one of the main differences with Euler. There is this quantization for Gross-Pitaevskii, which you do not need for Euler. So I consider 2 pi times the integration along the curve x of, so this is a vector distribution, this is just circulation of along the curve C. Now, when you have a line of current, I think in terms of electromagnetic, you have an induction capital B, which satisfies these divergence B equals to zero, and the curl is exactly capital J, which you recover by Biot-Savart. And when you have the induction, you can go to the vector potential, which satisfies now these sets of equations, and then you get the vector Laplace equation of the vector potential is equal to J. Now, if you are in cylindrical coordinates, I will take just one point here in the half plane, little a, and I will tell you what is a Dirac, the equivalent of a Dirac mass for Euler, is a Dirac along the circle, and so the capital A is just a solution of a vector Laplace equation with a Dirac on the right hand side, which you can write in this way. You can you can tell what the capital A is even with complete elliptic integrals. This is something that that can be done, but it is not really the most important part. The thing is that since there is a 2 pi here, we can define Gross-Pitaevskii vector field U that will be related to capital A, and in the sense that its vorticity will be precisely this singular circle. Okay, and what you do basically is you use this formula. Forgot about the little r. This is something just because we are in cylindrical coordinates. But what you say is that the gradient of the phase of U is just the gradient perp of the potential. Okay, so this would behave like a log close to the singularity, and so the phase will look like a typical Dirac vortex in 2D. You get this equation, this sets of equations for U. So the curl is 2 pi delta, and the divergence of J is zero up to this change of of metrics. So this is the equivalent of vortex points. Now I have to say what is the equivalent of circular patches. Circular patches were the optimizers for energy. The optimizers for energy in the Ginzburg-Landau framework are known, and they are called vortices as well. So they have this particular form. They behave like exponential I theta. So this is in 2D, and they have a profile, which is like this. So we'll get a profile. This is the modulus of U will look like that around the singularity. It will not be x over modulus of x, but you regularize it by something which has a width of order epsilon. And this is energetically optimal in a sense. It is the best way to regularize a singular vortex rings in the context of the Gross-Pitaevskii equation. And then you define your field just in this way. So this would be the equivalent of a disk, of a vortex disk in the 2D Euler. Now, if you want to take many of them, since you have essentially unimodular maps in C, you just multiply them. So this would be the singular one. You multiply the complex fields, and the singular ones, you also multiply them. So now you have defined this way a field which has a number, A1, A2, which has a number of vortex rings at different points. And you can compute the expansion for its energy. I have written it here. And also check that its vorticity is close to the sum of Dirac masses. And here is the difference with respect to Euler. In Euler, the L1 norm was a natural candidate, well, the used candidate to measure the spreading of vorticity. In Gross-Pitaevskii, it turned out that the dual of Lipschitz function is something which is well behaved and which also has some advantages because it tracks more the fact that small parts want to go to infinity. For the W minus 1, 1 norm, if a small part goes to infinity, you see the distance at which it goes. Whereas for the L1 norm, you just see that it's not there, but it does not make, the L1 norm does not make the difference between being at distance 1 and being at distance 1,000 from there. So in some sense, this is something, this is kind of estimates that would be nice to have in Euler 2 rather than L1 distances. And the second important thing here is that the main term in the energy now depends, of course, on the position of the points. And not only this is the equivalent of the interaction in the log xi minus xj, which we add into D now, there is a main term here which depends on the position of the vortex rings. Okay, so since Gross-Pitaevskii is the Hamiltonian flow for the Gross-Pitaevskii equation, at the limit one would expect that the position of the vortex rings obey the Hamiltonian flow for the limit energy which we computed, which is H epsilon, which I just wrote here. And this will actually be the content of the theorem. I just mentioned that this flow here, which I call the leapfrogging ODE, in addition to the Hamiltonian, as a conserved quantity, which is the momentum, which is just the sum of the square of the radii of the vortex rings. And actually, not for the ODE, but for the full Gross-Pitaevskii, we have seen that there was the conservation of this, which was the equivalent of the angular momentum for Euler. And for patches, you have the same asymptotic. So this is No, don't pay attention to 39. This sorry. Okay, so now the statement of the theorem. I claim that the right scaling to see the interaction between vortices is this one. So when vortex cores are at a distance of order 1 over square root of log. So I wrote them as a main point A0. And the distance here are of order 1 over square root of log. Somehow, if they are closer then the effect of being 3D will not be seen. If they are too close, they would behave like the 2D, like straight vortex filaments, and one would recover the equivalent of Marcureau and Pulvirenti result. And if they are too far apart, then they will just behave like vortex rings with too few interactions between them, and there will not be an interesting limit ODE. And the theorem is the following. So this is an assumption on the initial data, and I assume that I have a bound. No, I let those points evolve by the limit, what I think to be the limit ODE. And I, in the statement of the theorem, I assume that the BI epsilon of S remains bounded. Okay, this is something you always have for some times, and we will see later even for times of order one, maybe a little bit bigger in some regime. I assume that initially my vorticity is concentrated close to those points. This is what I call the concentration scale. And I assume that the energy of my initial data is not too much bigger than that what I expect to be the optimal energy for such configuration of points. I do not claim that this is the optimal one. It will be at little O of one. This will be a consequence of the theorem, but I just assume that I have not too much energy, and this is what I call the excess. And the theorem says that if both the concentration scale and the excess are not too big initially, then they remain not too big for a time of order one. And this I can make as small as I wish by my initial data, and we have this loss which we cannot which comes from technicalities in the proof. There has to be something here, and the point is that we have an exponential here, but with no singularity in epsilon. There is no one over epsilon or something like that here, whereas there was a one over epsilon square in the equation. So for order one, we can say that the behavior of the, for times of order one, we can say that the behavior of the Gross-Pitaevskii equation is essentially the same as the behavior of the leapfrogging ODE. Now the leapfrogging ODE, I have depicted here its phase diagram when there are only two vortex rings. In that case, so there are four free parameters, because each A1 and A2 both have 2 degrees of freedom. But because of conservations, first you can, you have the momentum that fixes one leaf. And there is also a translation invariance. If I have those 2 points and I move them by a fixed vector in the z direction, the motion will be equivariant with this transformation. So I can just look at the difference between the altitudes of the two annuli and use it as a function to describe the Hamiltonian. And the other one, as I said, was the conservation of the momentum p. So and p was the sum of the square radius of the two. So I can define this new variable eta by these 2 quantities. The sum is always p, and so eta, if eta is equal to 1 or minus 1, means that one of the two vortex rings is much bigger than the other one, and when eta is 0, it just means that they have the same radii. And so if you plot the Hamiltonian h epsilon in terms of eta and z, then you get this phase diagram. And so you see that here in the center you have a region where solutions are periodic, which means that so eta goes from positive to negative and z positive negative, which is exactly what you observed in the video, in the sense that sometimes one annuli is smaller and the other one is bigger, and they catch each other. But there are different regions here, so this would correspond to the place where the vortex rings have too much different radii initially, and so they will interact. You see, the one is going closer to the other one, but the difference is too big, and it's not catched by the other one, and it will flow inside. For example, you take a very small one and a very big one in front, it will pass through, but it is not sufficiently close to interact truly with it in long time. It will escape. But there are also some very nice regions here where one will come closer, that one will accelerate, it will not pass inside, but they will finish like this. So it comes close, and then that one goes in this direction. You can also at least numerically look at the that the leapfrogging systems for three or more vortex rings. There are some very nice examples, like for the point vortex like for the point vortex systems. Okay, so I do not have time. I had some slides on the proof, but I think my time is over. So I just finished to say that one would like to do the same for Euler. The difficulty is the concentration. And so the main question, I think, the one good way to try to tackle it is replace the L1 norm in the Vega Sideris or one pool Virenti estimates by a norm which is more adapted to catch the part of the vorticity that would want to go to infinity. Is it possible to do it with dual of Lipschitz? We've tried that, and this is actually wrong. But one may think of other way to measure the expansion of vorticity in this filamentation problem in Euler. But this is a difficult question on which we have failed.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Questions or remarks?
So maybe I have one question. If we see on the face, so they are periodic orbits, huh?
Yes.
And so they are of which order? Because it means that. So you can see many circles. I mean, in your.
Yes. So this require a time of order one. So. If this is of size k times square root of log epsilon, this will be essentially exponential of k. So these are actually very flat things. So the motion is actually it's periodic in time, but it does not look like something that does this. But it more does when k is big. It's just something like that. You don't see anything for a long time, and then it exchanges. You wait for a long time, and then it exchanges again. When you get closer to the heteroclinic here, and this is.
And it is you see many periods
in this theorem we can actually go to times that are log of epsilon and well, log of epsilon is one. It really depends on the constant which you have in front if you really want to have figures, but this requires a time of order one in this scaling. So in principle, if we take epsilon very, very small, we can see many leapfroggings. Many of those, we can follow. It's not just one part of the branch. No, we can see many of it.
Are there some other questions? Yes.
What happens if for your unimodular map at each circle you change the degree? Say you take opposite degree for.
Yes. I have a video for that. So now that the two in the leapfrogging set they are both going in the same direction and they interact. Now, if you take different signs in the vorticity, they will collide, well, or depending on where they are. This is also a video by Lim, and the life seems to be much more complicated in that case. Yeah. Mathematically, you would say there is something which you don't like because you start in a cylindrically symmetric situation and you see the solution is no longer cylindrically symmetric. But life is never cylindrically symmetric. This video is very popular in the fluid mechanics community because you see you recover some vortex rings which have. Each of them has half of a part, which initially was. This. And also, this is a real experiment. This is not a simulation. You see another vortex rings which have these calving waves. So this is probably much more difficult when you take opposite vorticities.
Thank you very much again for this nice talk. Thank you.